Yeah. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our afternoon panel on global economic outlook, growth or stagnation, big question mark. We have a terrific lineup of speakers. I am the moderator. My name is Jan Svejnar. I'm professor here and also direct the Center on Global Economic Governance. I will not give you long introduction to each of the speakers because you have it on the flyer. Besides, you probably know all of them. But let me just say we'll start with Takatoshi Ito, who is professor of international public affairs here at SIPA, Columbia University, has an illustrious career in Japan and worldwide. Then after him we'll have Arminio Fraga, who is former president, Central Bank of Brazil, and again, very illustrious academic as well as practical career. Followed by Joe Stiglitz, who is the university professor here at Columbia University, 2001 Nobel Prize laureate in economic sciences. And on my left here, Shang-Jin Wei, colleague here also at SIPA and also at the business school, and illustrious career, including chief economist of the Asian Development Bank, from where he just returned, therefore has very fresh news. Each of them will start with a set of introductory remarks, then we'll give them a chance to go at each other after those remarks, and then we'll open it up for discussion, questions, answers from the floor, and I will intervene as needed, both to control them and to contribute if I think that it's needed. So let's start with Takatoshi Ito. Taka, thank you.
Thank you. So my role is to give you some overview and outlook of the Japanese economy and possibly extending to the rest of the Asia except China, which is, will be covered by Shang-Jin. Okay, so Japan has experienced very painful the stagnation and deflation in the last 20 years. And that is essentially over. And the political chaos in some like six prime ministers in 6 years between 2006 and 2012 is over. Mr. Abe has been in prime ministership in the last 4 years and probably stay in the next 4 years too. And he has introduced the so-called Abenomics, which is the package of the economic policy, monetary policy, fiscal policy, and growth strategy. So Japanese economy has got out of stagnation and deflation, and now on the steady course of the growth for Japan and poised to continue to do so. However, there are some challenges and going forward, and we'll see how Japan will deal with those challenges. First one is the inflation or getting out of deflation. So the deflation is over, as I said, but the inflation rate is still around 0% to 0.5%, which would be envy from the Latin America, but it is a bit too slow for a Japanese target of 2%. So without sort of 2% target, it's very difficult to do adjustments in the real wage or the real price adjustments and so on. So we do need 2%, just like US or Europe or any other inflation targeter advanced countries. How to get the inflation rate going up with very strong monetary and fiscal stimulus which have been applied is an immediate question that Bank of Japan and the government have been struggling with. Second challenge is the fiscal problem or the gross debt of the government. The Japan has applied those strong fiscal stimulus, so now we are having 240% of debt to GDP ratio. Argentina got into trouble. I think around 60 or 70% of the gross debt to GDP ratio. Greece got into trouble at around 130%. Now, Japan's level is unprecedented in peacetime. And how this will play out is a big question. Some people predict a fiscal crisis in 5 years, and some people think, no, it's okay, because all the debts are held by Japanese domestic residents, and 40% now are held by Bank of Japan. So it's a wash between government liability and central bank assets. Well, we will see how this will play out, because this is, again, unprecedented. In the medium term, like 5 years to 10 years, the difficulty of losing population, shrinking population, will become severe. And right now we are suffering from losing working age population. We are losing like 7 million people in 10 years. So just shy of 1 million a year we are losing. So baby boomers are retiring, and the entering population is much smaller than that. And how to deal with this working age, losing working age population is a question. Well, Abe, Prime Minister Abe has introduced number of measures to help the women to participate. The working mothers have been tended to withdraw from the labor market. Now we have a lot of measures, so women participation rate has been rising, which is good. We could use more elderly workers, because the Japanese elderly tend to be healthy, but they still have the 65 as the age limit, retirement age. That's why I have to come to the U.S. to continue work. So they can do a lot to removing that age discrimination. The third, that Japan can import foreign workers, that there are still a lot of Asians who would be happy to be working in Japan. But there are some political, social stigma attached to those welcoming large number of foreigners. There are some foreigners working in Japan, increasing, but it's kind of backdoor way. Fourth, that Japan is promoting robots to work, and it's not only industrial robots, but now the robots are in the healthcare sector. They are lifting the patients and going to the bathtub and dip into the bathtub, wash, and put him back. So maybe we can have more use of the robots, and maybe we can tax robots so that tax revenues will go up. And in general, that innovation, of course, is a key to raise real wage and wealth. So Japan has been, I think, dropping in the ranking of per capita income in OECD countries. And it's not just inflation, fiscal deficit, and so on. We need the innovation to happen so that real wage could go up without hurting the growth process. Now, just last word is that these Japanese problems of demographic problems, losing working age population, and so on, is not unique to Japan, will not be unique to Japan. It's going to be a problem in China soon, and it's going to be a problem of many other industrial countries. So Japan is the first to experience these challenges, and the first country to hopefully overcome these problems. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Taka. It's very stimulating, and I'm sure there will be quite a lot of reaction to that. And let's move now to Brazil and Latin America. Arminio, what's the situation there?
Thank you. Thank you, Jan. Mostly going to talk about Brazil. For the region as a whole, right now, short term, things seem okay from the standpoint of the outside world. However, now thinking about Latin America in particular, there's fear all over about higher rates. We have a long history of kind of boom-bust cycles with liquidity flooding and then running away, and also protectionist tendencies are a problem, particularly for Mexico, that has now to deal with a new government here. This old kind of El Norte thing is back. But it's not just that. And it's the last thing I'll say about Mexico. But it's pretty clear, looking back 20 years, that Mexico has not grown as much as most people would have thought. But I'll leave it at that. I want to make Brazil the main focus. There's a lot going on there. As I'm sure most of you know, but just in case, there are three important simultaneous crises taking place in Brazil as we speak. There's an economic crisis, there's a political crisis, and then there's a kind of crisis of values or moral crisis. They all are very hard to cure, and I think in inverse order. I think the economic crisis, believe it or not, is probably the easiest, but it depends on the other factors, and I'll get back to that. On the economic side, I'm going to give you a very, very quick summary, going back a bit. I don't have that much time, just so you know about what's going on and a little bit of where we came from. So where are we now? We hopefully are at the end of a depression. And why do I say this is a depression? It hasn't lasted that long. Hopefully it won't. But we've had a double-digit decline in income per capita. I think we could end up having a double-digit decline in income, period. As labor force grows, it's still around 1%. So it's a massive recession. Now, the amazing thing is it's the second time we go down 10% on a per capita basis in 30, 40 years. We had another such event in the 80s. And it's really hard to imagine a nice, smooth development path if every now and then you go bust. But that's kind of where we are. It's important to try to figure out what is driving this. And here it pays to look around the region. And if you look at what happened to Latin America since the end of the commodity boom that ended right around 2010, with 8 years of President Lula were exactly coincided with the boom in Brazil. It's two terms. He probably thinks he did it. So here's the number. So now we have about what six years since then, and if you do the per capita growth numbers for Brazil and then for the rest of the region, is more dependent on commodities than Brazil. Just so you know. Brazil was below the average by 2.6% per year. 2.6 per year adds up to a lot. So clearly, this is not a terms of trade problem. That didn't help, no doubt. But it's something more serious. Now, what is this? Let me give you a couple more numbers. If you look at Brazil since 1950, 1950 was the beginning of a period of very fast growth down there, the so-called Brazilian miracle. We did quite well, but then we kind of hit some bumps, hyperinflation, debt default, and so on and so forth. When you add up the whole thing, President Cardoso did well, Lula did well, you add up the whole thing, and Brazil has been converging, say, towards the U.S. standards or the top global standards at what I think is a very slow pace. It's below 0.5% a year. And so Brazil started out at about an eighth of the U.S. in 1950. It did double relative to the U.S. circa 1980. But then since then, Brazil has grown less than the U.S. And is now below 20% of the U.S. income per capita. So kind of that's the story on the numbers side. Now, the question is why? Why has this been frustrating? And it's in many dimensions, I'm skipping a lot here. So my hypothesis is that on the economic side of things, Brazil just picked the wrong model. And the model Brazil picked back then was a closed economy, focused on industrialization, then infrastructure model with massive state presence in production and also very heavy intervention, but no focus on education, no focus on productivity. So we kind of isolated ourselves from the world, and then and our people have been suffering from very poor education system. Not surprisingly, Brazil has not invested that much. Brazil has also been a low saving economy, we've also had recurring macroeconomic problems, and it was mentioned here 2%, but we've had hyperinflation, price freezes, debt defaults, you name it. Now, I guess the question is why, right? But let me keep moving, because I'm not sure I know a nice clean answer. Maybe there isn't one. Maybe there is. What is happening now, I believe very strongly, was caused by similar policies. Again, we kind of left it for a while, all kinds of nice things, reforming the state, the focus on education, on health, on regulation, macro stability plus. And then we kind of veered away from this, and the results, again, not surprisingly, were a disaster. I'm not religious about some of the things we've been doing down there. I was a student of Joe's. I do think, and I'm not a proponent of a minimalist state or any of that. I think the government can do a lot, but the government can do a lot of harm as well if you don't watch it, and that's unfortunately been the case for the most part in Brazil. So this recent depression, like I said, had similar features. There was this nostalgia about this era of fast growth, and we somehow keep going back to it, forgetting that it led us nowhere. Now, there's a couple important changes. I think, at least in the recent period, there's been a focus, an important focus, on fighting poverty, especially extreme poverty. And there has been some improvement in the distribution of income, probably one of the few countries in the world that can say that. Of course, we started out from extremely uneven, and now we're down to a little less extremely uneven, but still very uneven. But there's been some improvement. Now, why? Again, too much for 7 minutes. They probably have gone by now. But there are some features of this and that we've seen. And this focuses a bit more on the recent past. There's been a lot of populism, a lot. There's been massive corruption. This is not new, but it was taken to a new level. There have also been a lot of bad ideas, just bad policies, badly designed, and for a reason. And what the reason seems to be, one, that there are a lot of people still proposing all kinds of crazy things down there to this day. But beyond that, there's been this pervasive capture of the state by private and party interests. And this is a very important point. I mean, all the stuff that happened, all the many, many, many people going to jail, being tried, etc., wasn't the creation of one or two or three or five parties. They were there, for sure. They were in bed with private leadership in the country, and they were playing the game. And they were all kind of, they felt very privileged to be able to milk the state cow. But now the cow is kind of dead or dying. Now, the current version, the one that has us now against the ropes, has, again, a lot of macro problems, but slightly different ones this time. We have a floating exchange rate, and inflation has been reasonably low. The recent problem has been a substantial collapse in fiscal discipline. And for a country with the history of Japan, this is nothing. The U.S. now has 100% of GDP debt ratio. There's nothing magic about any of these numbers, but in our case, because we still have very high interest rates, the debt dynamics are very scary. So if you have low growth and high rates like we have, And then all of a sudden, you go from a primary surplus of 3 to 4% to a deficit of 3. The compounding is very, very damaging. And then there's this other feature that I mentioned, that there is a degree of corruption that has gone up to a new level, but was also connected to an attempt at kind of staying in control of the state apparatus and in control of politics in general. Now, recently, the president has been impeached. She seemed like a very stubborn person and didn't really get it as far as trying to find a new path for Brazil, and she kept doubling the wrong bets. But not because of that. She was impeached because of all kinds of other things happening. There's some newspapers portray this as a coup. It really isn't a coup. It is true that she was impeached by a number of many politicians who were equally corrupt. So, but it's not the point. But it was done according to the law, following, you know, due process and all that. And we've had now, you know, in the middle of this chaos, sort of a transitory government ran by people who were in bed with the previous government, but who somehow managed to put together a solid group of people with good ideas. And despite all the political chaos, they've been proposing some good reforms, and markets have calmed down for now, and in fact, there's been a strong bounce because people thought we were going to have a crisis that was probably twice the size of the one we ended up having. I for one, think that would have been the case. But the fact is, society in Brazil remains in deep pain. Unemployment is very high. People are in despair. There's no trust in the system, no trust in pretty much in most key players. And here's the politics that I mentioned in the beginning. We have 29 parties in our Congress. There's no ownership as a result, no long-term vision. And our Congress, you know, was in a way part of this whole story because of that. So all of that is very complicated. Moving on to conclude, there are some things, however, that are working. And hopefully we'll drag us out of this. We've remained, and I'm sure we will remain, a democracy. There's an understanding that our democracy needs to be improved. Issues like accountability, campaign financing, and the large number of parties are being addressed. A lot of this happening under daylight, because we have a free and very, very strong and very energetic press, I should say, not just conventional. There's freedom of sort of 21st century media channels as well. The judiciary, the public prosecutors, and the police are also doing their part. And so we're seeing something amazing. You know, we're seeing a huge number of important senior business leaders going to jail. That process happened sooner. And now we're starting to see the trials of the of political leaders who have this strange status in Brazil, that they can only be judged by the Supreme Court, which is makes it complicated because there are too many. They're just going to be very busy. Okay, so what do we need here, briefly? And I'm not going to present any kind of program, just a checklist in case you want to follow Brazil. It's clearly we need empowered leadership with good ideas to go deeper on things and do what needs to be done. We need political reform urgently. I touched upon that very briefly. That should lead to a fundamental reform of our state that is completely unaccountable. We've had all these experiments in economic policy, unbelievable number of crazy things. There's been no evaluation, zero, trust me, zero. There's very little data, very little work. We, of course, must go way past the famous Bolsa Família program, the family stipend program. There's a wonderful program, but it costs 2% of GDP, and they're granting subsidies to businesses to the tune of 15 times that or something. So that needs to be done. we need to get back on some kind of macro discipline track, and I also think we need truly pro-growth policies. It's hard to say where we're going to be in 100 years, or even 10, or even 2. But I'm despite all I'm saying, and I'm very sad about my country. I must say, really terribly sad. But maybe this is a turning point. It could be. It should be. And so we'll see. We'll wait to see what happens. In 2018, we'll have elections for president, and hopefully there'll be something. You know, there's likely to be a massive recycling of actors in this world. So there's still room for a populist to come in and say, you know, the system was okay. All you need was somebody who's more honest and capable of dealing with urban violence and whatnot, and somebody like that may get elected. But it may not. There we have it. Not a good moment, but hopefully this will be the beginning of something. Thank you.
Arminio, thank you for the optimistic note on which you ended. It's certainly important for Brazil and the whole world. Now, Joe Stiglitz, who needs no introduction, I should just say he can cover a lot of ground very fast. So we figured that he can cover the U.S. and Europe plus the ocean between in his introductory remarks.
Joe? Okay, well, thank you. And I think it was good that you began with Japan, because that's the bright spot in the world. And as you're going down from there to Brazil and then to the United States, it's just downhill. As you all know, we had an election. U.S. was in the process of a recovery, and what I want to describe is very briefly where there are a lot of uncertainties about where we are going economically. I won't talk about politically, just economically. But there are a lot of uncertainties about that related to policy. The markets have been very optimistic, and that's basically, I think, some people put it a sugar high, in the belief that they're going to get tax cuts, regulatory cuts, and a lot of people in the business community are just narrowly, in a short-sighted way, thinking about the consequences of what that will mean to their profits. And you have to remember the stock market, a very big part of the stock market, I think it's about 20%, is the financial sector. Financial sector, as you may recall, had a little problem back in 2008, but the Trump administration doesn't remember that. And I actually was in a dinner with Steve Schwartzman, who was one of the Trump's advisors, and he was all enthusiastic about financial sector deregulation. And somebody said, "Didn't we have a crisis in 2008?" And he couldn't remember it. So they're ignoring some of the downside risks that might come from that. But let me go through the specific basis of what I think is this irrational exuberance that they're feeling. First, on the tax cut, the particular proposal that has been the center of the discussion, called the Ryan Brady proposal, almost surely won't go through. It involves a reform of the tax and a lowering of the corporate income tax, but the imposition of what they call a cross-border adjustment, which is basically a tariff on all foreign inputs and a subsidy to our exports. And it is almost certainly WTO illegal, and almost certainly our trading partners will take actions and won't wait for the WTO court to rule. I think that they would probably, if we passed it, impose countervailing duties, which they would be able to do just immediately after it was passed. And so the hope for benefits that they get from the trade advantage would not occur, and it would be the opening shot in a trade war. You might say the good news is that won't happen, almost surely. And the only question is when they will realize that the Ryan Brady plan won't go through and probably turn to more modest cuts in the corporate income tax of the usual variety, which is tax cuts for the rich, in the belief that a tax cut for the rich is a solution to every problem. And it will not have a particular effect in stimulating the economy. It will have a it will increase the deficit. Their original idea was a neutral tax reform. I think the general view is they've given up on that. That when they balance their greed versus a sense of fiscal balance, they all said greed wins, and so they will go for the a bigger tax cut than they can be paid for. So and it will be balanced toward the reports are that it will be even more regressive than the 2001-2003 tax cuts. I don't think it will have much effect in stimulating investment. It's not lack of funds that are inhibiting investment. They're sitting on a corporation sitting a couple trillion dollars of funds. And there's some theoretical arguments why, because interest is tax deductible, although it wouldn't be in the Brady-Ryan plan, another reason why it won't go through. But because it's tax deductible, the marginal the balance between marginal cost and marginal benefit investment is basically unaffected by the corporate income tax in the range of the ones that they're talking about. So there'll be a small tax cut. It won't really change dramatically things. The fact that the tax cut isn't fully is going to increase the deficit almost also means that the infrastructure bill that will be passed will be much smaller than the $1 trillion that was originally discussed. Likely to be much, much smaller. It's interesting that 8 years ago, they've forgotten, memory is short, 8 years ago they talked about all the reasons why infrastructure investment didn't stimulate the economy, especially if it was what was called shovel ready. That if you want infrastructure projects that really have an effect, it takes time, and we're talking about 2, 3, 4 years, and so there's been very little discussion about the structure of what it is. Again, a lot of the discussion, from what one can tell, a lot of the provisions are that they would be organized through a tax credits, and that what more likely, you know, and there are some things that, and for privatization things, and there are only certain kinds of investments that can be organized that way. Areas where you have high social returns often cannot be done that way. So there's an expectation there'll be a lot of more privatizations of prisons because the prisoners don't have much voice in that kind of actions. But that's not going to increase the productivity of the U.S. economy. So I don't think, again, I think there's been a little bit irrational optimism on that. The third area where there's been very little on the business community's focus is the consequences of Trump's protectionism. And I think the good news is that it won't go anywhere near, again, what his campaign talked about. And there have been some recent articles saying, look at, some of us who looked at NAFTA, you might say, what's wrong with NAFTA? You could identify what's wrong with it. But almost most of the things that are wrong with it, very hard to fix and very hard, won't have any effect on the bilateral trade deficit. And what's particularly difficult is they won't, the U.S. has a problem. We have a trade surplus with Canada. So what we want to do is maintain our trade surplus with Canada, but get rid of the trade deficit with Mexico and have the same rules apply. And they haven't figured out how to do that. The way they talk about it is a extreme form of mercantilism, sort of basic 18th century mercantilism. They say there's a fundamental difference between trading goods and trading services. And so they say we have a, they don't want to talk about trading services. Obviously, we are interested in trading services because education is one of our big export industries, which is the trading services. Tourism, I don't know if you've seen the statistics, because of Trump, tourism to the United States is going down significantly. And dramatically. So people don't want to come to a country like that. And so that will worsen our balance of trade. So, but the proposed reforms in NAFTA won't make much difference. And that's one of the reasons why if you look at the peso, it went way down, and now as people start thinking about what really is likely to happen, it's come way up. And so that's reflecting the fact that probably there was a lot of bark, very little bite, and but what is clear is that the damage is permanent and long-lasting. And what do I mean by that? Since World War II, the United States has led the way in trying to create a global war order in which borders don't matter and which is ruled by a rules-based system of international law. And I think it's worked. I've complained a lot because I think it's stacked against developing countries and emerging markets. And, you know, to me, to hear Trump say it's stacked against the United States and our negotiators did a bad job, I don't think he knows what's happened for the last 50 years because our negotiators got everything they asked for. I mean, I'm sure anybody from any developing countries will tell you that. Our negotiators sometimes asked for the wrong things because they were reflecting some corporate interest. But it wasn't like our negotiators were bad negotiators. They were actually, real bulldogs and got close to everything they wanted, and the real problem is too often they wanted the wrong thing. In the area of regulation, again, I think there's been a lot of hyperbole. The one area where there is likely to be a change is in bank regulation, not because Dodd-Frank is going to be changed. It's very hard to do that, but because the Federal Reserve will be less aggressive in stress tests and other actions and capital requirements, a lot of things that are interpretations of the regulations and the laws. It will be very difficult to actually change the actual regulations. What does this mean overall? Well, there's one other side that I haven't talked about, and again, which the market hasn't really taken fully into account. The United States has is not really at full employment, but in terms of the conventional measures, unemployment is very low. And the Fed pays a lot of attention to those conventional measures. And so while I'm not particularly worried about inflation, they are driven by looking at those conventional measures. And if aggregate demand goes up, if we cut taxes much, if we increase infrastructure spending very much, if we do increase military spending, they will raise the interest rate, and that will be a offsetting measure to whatever he does. So the irony is that the likelihood that anything that he does will have much effect in aggregate demand, taking account what the Fed does, is very very small. Now, he's talked about getting growth at to 4%, and I don't think there's any economist anywhere that thinks he will get anywhere above 3%, and the more likely number is more like 2%. And that's because 2% is really what U.S. potential growth is. And actually, some of his measures will have the effect of decreasing potential growth. Why do I say that? Well, there are two parts to potential growth. One is labor force growth, mentioned before. And labor force growth in the United States has been low, not negative, but relatively low, about 0.75%. A major part of the labor force, significant, is immigration. And he will make immigration more difficult and less attractive. The other part is productivity growth. And he has taken a very anti-science stance and, cutbacks to the basic science support, and all of that will, at least in the medium term, lead to lower growth in productivity. So, in fact, I think more likely than not, the numbers that we'll have will be around 2%, maybe a little above 2%, and that the net effect of his policies over a medium term is actually going to be negative. Finally, on the big issue that probably influenced the election, inequality, it's very clear that his policies will make inequality worse. A regressive tax system will make it worse. Had he succeeded in getting his health care bill through, it would have made, depriving some 26 million people of health care is going to make that problem worse. And I don't know if you follow the results. America is unique among the advanced countries in which our life expectancy is going down. And especially among those groups, the Rust Belt workers, male workers, the declines in life expectancy have been very significant and dramatic, where morbidity, the probability of death, is now markedly worse than in any other advanced countries among males. And in fact, among non-white, non-college graduates, it's actually now worse than even among blacks, African Americans. So things have not been going well. Let me just say one word about Europe, and that's very simple. Europe is likely to continue in stagnation, and that's mainly because of the euro. And if you want to understand why, you should get my book, The Euro.
Very good. Thank you. So Europe got a short but very significant shrift here, as you can see. Now, the last but not the least is, of course, the gem, the optimistic, the country that can save us all, and that's China. And there are very few people who have better sense of what's happening there than Shang-Jin Wei. So Shang-Jin, take it all.
Thank you, Yang. Well, in the last two millennium, most of the times, Asia accounted for perhaps half of the global production and consumption. So in that sense, it was the center of gravity for the world economy. And about 250 years ago, Asia went to a deep sleep, especially including the two largest, most populous countries, China and Asia. And then around 1980, China followed the models of Japan and the four small dragons to start its reforms, and growth rate started to pick up. And then a decade later, India started to do the same thing. At least since 2000, since the beginning of this century, Asia collectively accounted for half of the global growth, somewhere between half to thirds. And China alone, since 2000, has been accounting for about one third of global growth. Looking forward, I can't tell you what will happen in the next 2,000 years, but I think in the next two decades, there's a very high probability that Asia will remain to be the most dynamic, fastest growing region in the world, and that includes China's share in global growth, and India's is doing very well as well. India will grow faster than China and stay that way for a long time, but because India, the economic size is only 1/3 of China, so the contribution to global growth in the short term will not be as large as China, but will increase. There are clearly risks facing those economies, starting with the largest economy in the region, China. There are domestic risks and there are external risks. In my view, there are two types of domestic risks that perhaps I will highlight. Perhaps the biggest short-term domestic risk is a potential crash of a housing market. So Chinese housing prices, as many of you might know, have been rising very fast and reached very ridiculously high level relative to the country's household income, relative to the rent when the same kind of house can get from the market, and relative to international experience. Now, of course, many people in the country thought, we are so unique, so different in this and that many ways, and therefore whatever you see in other countries probably will not happen to China. Now, one thing one knows from history of global asset price bubbles, one common feature is that before the bubble bursts, everyone in the country will tell you why they are special, and they will laugh at those who predict a crash of a bubble. And I think at the moment there's still a way to induce a soft landing, but it is a risk nonetheless that there's some non-trivial chance, and this could cause economic instability, which can spill over into social instability. Over longer horizon, I think one of the major risks facing the largest economy in Asia is demographics, similar to what Taka said about Japan. So China essentially lagged behind Japan by about 11 years in terms of demographic pattern. The negative demographic feature already shows up in the data. So Chinese working age cohort has been shrinking in absolute size starting from 2011, roughly the rate about 0.8% a year. This means other things equal. Even if there's no change in productivity, no change in other fundamentals, this by itself would give you a lower GDP growth rate. Now, this risk has been recognized to some degree, and government starting from the end of 2015 had taken some steps to try to reverse that. Most notably, government announced the relaxation of a family planning policy from the previous very strict one child per couple policy to now two children per couple. This relaxation of family planning policy, meant to overcome the demographic challenge, in the next two decades, will make dependence ratio worse off, will make growth actually worse off. Why? Because no couple has figured out a way to produce a 20-year-old right away. So in the next 2 years, you actually will not, this change in policy will not fundamentally change how many people will be entering workforce. And yet, many more dependents, babies, need to be helped by working people will increase due to this policy. Now, after two decades, the change in policy will help with demographics. But we need to understand this transitional dynamics, the role of transitional dynamics play in this wheel. These are domestic risks that I will highlight. There are international risks. One prominent one is the Trump policy risk. The border adjustment tax that people have different views about how likely they will be enacted. The mere talk of this, the possibility that some such thing could happen, provides induces disturbance in currency market, in financial markets, and that actually is a bigger problem for other countries in Asia than for China itself. Many countries in Asia continue to have foreign currency and debt. Even China, that used to have zero foreign currency debt, but in the last few years, firms have been acquiring foreign currency debt. And foreign currency, China, but the problem for China is not as severe as some of the other countries I don't want to name in Asia. And those countries that have noticeably higher foreign currency debt are very vulnerable to dollar appreciation. So one consequence of a border adjustment tax, or talks of a border adjustment tax, is to induce dollar becoming stronger. And we see some of this already, which means the flip side of this, currencies of other countries will experience depreciation or devaluation. And those movements creates a problem for those countries if they have a lot of foreign currency debt. So that's one risk. The other risk is potentially aggressive trade actions against China, which Trump and President Trump has mentioned more than once. Now we hope Joe will be right that those things will not, those policies will not be materialized, but there's some risk that some version of those could be put into place. Now one note I will make, the direct effect on China is relatively straightforward. If they makes it more expensive for China to export things to the U.S., they will have negative impact on Chinese exports and jobs. The point I want to highlight, however, is that the aggressive trade policies on China will have negative impact on many other countries in Asia and potentially beyond Asia. And that's because we now live in a global value chain world. And let me make them concrete. Roughly half of Chinese exports to the U.S. are value-added coming from Japan, Korea, Taiwan, and other economies. So that any policy that will reduce Chinese exports to the U.S. will feed indirectly, but very quickly, to total exports from other countries. Some of them might hope to increase the exports to U.S. directly, but the indirect channel will be very sizable. It's a non-trivial thing to reorganize global value chain. So that's actually one important point to keep in mind, that the trade actions on China will spill over in very concrete ways to other countries and not in a positive way. So that's a risk to Asian economy well. Let me stop here for now.
Thank you very much. All right, so we have a tour of the world here in the introductory remarks. They took a little bit longer than expected. Some speakers stuck to the limit, others did not. So we'll punish them a little bit by not letting them go at each other. I will provide just a little bit of background that I think is still needed, pose a few questions, and then we'll add your questions to it and have the speakers respond. So I would just like to add it in terms of background that there is some optimism in the world in the following sense. The last 5 years have really had the world experience much slower growth than one expected. Every year when you looked at the forecast, be it the International Monetary Fund or whoever else, they were optimistic and had to be downgraded in the sense because the world economy did not grow as fast as expected. So there was about a 3% average growth worldwide. Now the expectation is that growth will be faster, right? So there is this pregnant optimism, if you want, but at the same time also an incredible amount of uncertainty, and you could see that in the introduction of the speakers. And so the question is, will this uncertainty turn out to be unwarranted? Will it not be as much in practice and the world economy will really grow and there will be a positive spiral? Or will some of these negative effects really materialize? And let me just add a couple points on Europe, because I think it's really important. As you know, there is the Brexit phenomenon, which so far have not had a major negative effect, but I think that's really over the next couple of years and beyond, that we'll see the other shoe drop in terms of how much of a negative effect there could be. There is, of course, the French election at the end of April, second round and beginning in May, where should Marine Le Pen and her party win, there could be a potential for Frexit, French exit from the European Union, in which case that would probably be the beginning of disintegration of the entire project since World War II. Again, uncertainty, which has certain probability, hopefully not that high. You have the very precarious situation among the Italian banks, which could transcend Italy and have a huge shock on the European economy. And there is, of course, the rotation at the helm of the European Central Bank, with Mario Draghi leaving and presumably a more pro-German in his views or her views head of the European Central Bank coming in, which could also provide a shock given where the policies were now, quantitative easing, et cetera, keeping Europe afloat. So that could change. Now, to put it in perspective, 25 years ago, the US plus Europe were about 60% of world's GDP, so whatever happened there more or less determined what was going on. It's now shrunk to a little bit over 40%, the fastest decline, economic decline of a given empire, if you want, the Western US and Europe, but still extremely important. So what will happen in the US, and as you can see, there are, you know, major issues here, and what will happen in Europe, again, major issues, I think will affect things dramatically, and the question is to what extent emerging markets like China, India, and other countries can provide a counterpoise to it. So let me ask a question to each of the speakers, then we'll collect a few more questions and let them come back with their answers. So my question for Taka is, you've correctly pointed out that the debt-to-GDP ratio in Japan is enormous by any standard, 240%, right? But the sense that one has is that this is really within the family. This is the debt that's mostly owned within Japan. So it's very different to other countries where they owe externally and the external creditor says, pay me back, right? So it's almost like it's like a, you and your buddies, your generation is having a party, and you're asking the grandchildren to pay for it when they grow up, right? So is there a worry about it, or should you have more of a party, invite us all along, and the generations in the future will repay it, right? Arminio, the stock market in Brazil has done surprisingly well over the last year or so. Is this reflecting the realistic expectations, the positive things that you sort of hinted at, maybe didn't develop fully, or is it irrational exuberance and, you know, it's going to come down? Joe, I think your very realistic comments are on target. There is a group of people who are arguing that the decrease in the corporate tax will lead to sizable dynamic effects in terms of rising total factor productivity, and that that will bring about the positive effect, possibly growth. Is that at all a relevant argument in your view? And Shang-Jin, in terms of take China, India, but more generally, how severe would the protectionist effect be should the Trump administration really resort to, you know, if not fully trade war and, you know, significant protectionism? And to what extent will China, India, can we expect them to get much more involved in the global order and governance over the next few years? So that's by way of introduction. Let's see who else would like to ask questions. We have a microphone over there. Why don't we start right there near the microphone, and then we'll go on. We'll collect a few questions and then let the speakers respond. I'm reminding you that we started late, so we can go a little bit past the official deadline time. Please,
yes,
thank you.
Thank you. I would like to
identify yourself just briefly. And
I'm Beatriz Leisegui from Mexico. I'm an alumni from the class of 1990. I would like to ask Arminio Fraga, with regard to Mexico and Brazil's relationship. For the last few years, we have been trying to do a more ambitious free trade agreement between the two countries that, in my opinion, if Brazil and Mexico are able to strike a deal representing more than 50% of the region's trade, that could really lead to a leadership and a counterbalance also vis-a-vis the U.S. Do you foresee that this as a possibility at this moment? I know that negotiations are beginning to pick up again after the auto crisis. And for Professor Stiglitz, you have been a critic of the way free trade agreements have been negotiated in the past. And in this era in which President Trump is saying that he will renegotiate and redo the bilateral agreements he has, and the regional agreements as well, in the case of NAFTA, if the emergent countries could do differently and negotiate differently, what would you, and you were in that position, what would you request from the U.S. in order to have greater growth? And if, and my question is, if the trade agreement would really make a difference, or if it's more of the internal politics and internal domestic competitiveness agenda that would make a difference for our countries. Thank you.
Okay, we have it over there, right, laterally. Yeah, perfect.
A question for Professor Stiglitz, Michael Berto, class of 1995. I was wondering if you thought there would be a potential cut in the personal tax rate or the corporate tax rate, or both, because you called it regressive, so that implies the personal, but I wondered the prospects for a corporate tax rate. I wonder if you think the 35% statutory corporate tax rate is too high, and does it make the U.S. corporations non-competitive, as they claim? And then your thoughts on a potential repatriation bill. I think there are $2 to $3 trillion of U.S. corporate cash abroad. They've talked about some kind of deal at an 8% or 10% repatriation tax, and your thoughts on the potential for that. Thank you.
All right, we had a question right here. Let's move up front. Thank you.
Yes, given the fact that regardless of where you look, the world, John Porter, class of 1983, if I can remember. So if you look at the world economy, things actually aren't that bad in terms of growth. Even Europe seems to be growing for the third year, running above potential. UK doing well, US not bad. Do you think the absolute level of interest rates is actually doing more harm than good to the world economy? And I would actually direct those questions to Professor Stiglitz and Arminio Fraga, since he was in that seat at one point.
Okay, why don't we move across? Thanks.
Hi, Vikram Kapoor, class of 1993. This question is for Mr. Fraga. It's a two-part question. One is, you mentioned briefly that you see some recycling of politicians in Brazil. I wondered, the younger generation, let's say between the ages of 35 and 45, do you see any new class of politicians or any one or two people that you think could be very beneficial for Brazil? And then the other question that I have is, you mentioned the Bolsa de Família, which really helped put a lot of people into the middle class, poor people. And given the fact that Brazil is in a situation with continued high interest rates and low to no growth or contraction, do you see any kind of attempt at a similarly successful program going forward, given the pretty bleak economic outlook?
Yep.
Hi, thank you. Constance Hunter, SIPA 94, and I'm the chief economist at KPMG. And obviously the border adjustability tax is a big issue. I find it very curious that the Arbach-Holtz-Aiken camp is that there will be zero frictions, the dollar will automatically adjust, there will be no benefit to exporters, no harm to importers. And all of the exporters and importers chief economists seem to think that there will be 100% friction, and that the exporters will gain a huge advantage and the importers will be destroyed. So I'm wondering if you have thought about the extent of frictions. In my experience investing money in my former career, there are often great deal more frictions than policymakers anticipate.
Thank you. We had some questions over there. Okay.
Okay.
We have it. We have a microphone there.
Oh, you do? Okay.
Hello?
Oh, yeah, okay. Sorry, it wasn't working before. Yeah. Hi, thank you so much for the presentations. Super interesting. I had a quick question about what Stiglitz, Professor Stiglitz was mentioning and Shang Jinwei. So I'm going to direct this question towards them. And it's about the Rust Belt. So one could say that largely the Rust Belt tilted the election in Trump's favor, among other factors, of course. So what is the answer to their problems? And to what extent, if protectionist policies were to be implemented, would it help them or hurt them? And generally in the aggregate economy, who does it hurt and help? And yeah, I think that was the question. Yeah.
All right. Any more questions? If not, oh, there is one more. OK, let's do one more, and then we'll let the speakers respond.
Professor Stiglitz, please. About the role of the euro, until when is people going to hold the euro as an asset of value? You know, I haven't read your book about the euro. I'm sure it's good. But, you know, with the dynamics in the U.S. And, you know, these policies with Trump go wrong, then we could get into a position that, you know, the dollar is not going to be very attractive either.
All right. This is a question. Before he can buy the book, he wants the answers. Yeah. Anybody else? If not, come on, we'll have the speakers. Okay. Taka, let's start with you.
Okay, I have an easy task, no question from the floor, so I will answer Jan's question. So the Jan's question is that running up the deficits, but they are held by the domestic residents. Domestic residents like banks, right? So we households, savers, put the deposits in the banks. We don't care how the banks will invest as assets. Well, but in the macro terms, it does make huge difference. Okay, suppose banks invest in foreign bonds and domestic equities. They're the real assets, right? But if they invest in the government bonds, that is a liability of the government. So as a nation, that increase in government bonds as an asset of the banks mean that as a nation, the net equity is declining. So when you do the canceling out, what you have left, we don't have, we are declining. So down the road, suppose government defaults on the government bonds, it's not like Greece shifting the burden to the Germans. Government is shifting burden to the banks, and banks will shift the burden to the households. So that way, to avoid defaults, then the government has to increase taxes. Taxes on who? Those who are living there then, 20 years from now. So in that way, this government bonds held by the Japanese own the domestic residents mean that Japanese are getting poorer, and we are shifting the burden to the grandchildren. And you don't feel a pinch now, but certainly in down the road, when time comes, it's going to be a huge disappointment in the assets. So I think it's right to start raising taxes to punish ourselves, the baby boomers, and so that grandchildren will be saved.
So depending when you attended SIPA, in your economics theory, you learned about an overlapping generation models. So Japan is giving you an application so you can see how it's in practice now. Yeah. Arminio?
Thank you. So I have a few from relating to Brazil and one more macro. The stock market bounce, I think, was basically due to the change after the impeachment and the feeling that things would get better. Now that they've run a lot, valuations are no longer cheap, and so it's more of a kind of getting the new trends right, picking the right stocks and so on. I think the political jump took place. I think it made sense. The market was pricing in the end of the world. It didn't happen. The free trade with Mexico, would be fascinating. It's not easy. Mexico is in the middle of a relationship rethinking with the U.S., and Brazil is in the middle of one of rethinking with itself. Now we've been waiting for years for one big, amazing WTO deal that never came, and we stayed out of all the regional loops. So I'm with you. It would be a wonderful thing for us. Now I wonder if, under current circumstances, with the U.S. posing all kinds of threats to Mexico, whether they'll be doable. But I do think it will be a good thing if Mercosur, with or without Venezuela, it's now an issue, of course, given what's going on there, joins forces with the Pacific side of the region, so Mexico and the other countries, Chile, Colombia, Peru, etc. And I think it'll go that way. For now, I think the negotiations that are probably more advanced are those with Europe for us. And if we can get that done, that would be a great plus as well. I also think there's a lot we can do on our own because we're way out outside any kind of normal range in the planet. But it would be wonderful if we could do it. I just think it might take a while. On the political scene in Brazil, yes, I do think we will see younger faces, younger names, more charismatic names. Many are preaching kind of non-political solutions. I'm skeptical of that. Many people preaching honesty and efficiency. Those should be mandatory. You know? And then you need some kind of ideology on top of that. But I think that you see fantastic energy with younger people, and I do think they'll come along. And it will be very helpful. It's very hard to predict what Brazil will look like on the in as far as parties and ideas, but I do think it will be, there'll be a lot of younger people there, and many are already positioning for that. The Bolsa Família itself, there's this whole notion that Brazil jumped into the middle class. Yes, but it was a very, you know, you jumped just over the fence. It's not like the folks who were getting receiving the Bolsa Família, they made this huge jump and became middle class like we think of middle class here. And right now, many are going back because they were not that far from the fence, if you will. So what we need, I think, is a country that does deliver what people, the basic stuff people, you know, people get, they learn how to read and do basic math at third grade level and so on. I sometimes tell people, you know, in Brazil, we're not looking for the last 2% in the productivity kind of race. We're looking for the first 80% so we can get higher. But I think that comes with all the other challenges that I tried to briefly, not so briefly, I apologize, Ian, but bring to your attention, the political organization of the country, and also a battle of ideas as well as to what it is that we need to do. But yes, and then lastly, I guess I got that question because I was a central banker, I'm from a macroeconomist, so interest rates. Look, I think the interest rates we've seen reflect a number of different long and term and short term issues. The longer term are related to demographics and so on and so forth. And they move slowly. They're hard to predict. It's hard to tell. The rest is more kind of the sort of aftermath of a large crisis or some version of the secular stagnation thesis that includes the demand side. And I think we will see that naturally rates will go back to slightly more normal levels. I don't think they go back to where they were 20, 30 years ago here in the U.S. Too much has changed. I don't think central banks are in a big rush. They probably shouldn't be. But some strange things do happen while you're kind of providing, let's say, a massive dosage of steroids to an economy. And that's really what monetary policy is. It's kind of steroids, like in medicine. So I wonder. I'm not, at the moment, I think things are okay. I do, however, think, and this kind of goes to kind of pass the ball to Joe here, that we are at the tail end probably of a 30, 40-year bull market in bonds. Rates have declined in nominal real terms. I think that is over. So that was a spectacular for asset prices. This was like you're going with, for the most part, with a nice tailwind, and that might be over. So anyway, but TBD. Thank you,
Joe.
Okay. So first, let me pick up on the two questions about trade. First, on the trade agreements within the Americas that Arminio commented on. I've watched those for 25 years, and the United States has been the major impediment for the creation of a free trade agreement of the Americas for two reasons. One is that there's been a certain degree of political rivalry between the United States and Brazil. The United States' view is that we ought to dominate any free trade area of the Americas, and Brazil didn't always agree with us on that particular view. And the second one, and probably operationally more important, is that the United States refused to do anything about its agricultural subsidies. And for Argentina and Brazil, the commodity exporters, that was a no-go. If you didn't do anything about that, what does it mean to have a free trade area of the Americas? So I think, and I've been urging the countries of Latin America to really take advantage of the fact that the U.S. has completely stepped away and to begin talking about what kind of an agreement that they could forge. Part of this is, I can already tell you, Mexico and Colombia are talking a lot more about strengthening the Pacific Alliance and recognizing that they have to move, and this is a more general point, to a more multipolar world. And the sort of the world where the U.S. was at the center is clearly no longer viewed as a viable world. And that there will be a lot of changes moving, I think, in all parts of the world in that respect. On the broader issue of on trade negotiations, part of the issue on TPP, TTIP, and all that was the process, the lack of transparency. And I hope, although I don't have any confidence in the Trump administration, I hope that any new round of trade negotiations would have a higher standard of openness and transparency about how it's conducted and what's contained in it. If you were to ask what are some of the things that either, any of the countries ought to ask for, and say, beginning with NAFTA, the first thing is the change of the investment agreement in Chapter 11 in NAFTA, which are basically provisions designed to make it more difficult to regulate the environment, health, safety, even short-term capital flows were included under these provisions. So that has nothing to do with trade, but they are part of a trade agreement, and certainly I know that Canada would also like to get that changed. So but the business roundtable in the United States has been the major proponent. So once you open up that door of renegotiation, this will be on the table, and U.S. may be on the other side. The second thing is IPR, intellectual property rights, which have been in de facto mostly an attempt to get more property rights for big pharma at the expense of generics, and big corporations at expense of small corporations. So, for instance, if you look at TPP, BlackBerry came out very strongly against TPP. BlackBerry began as a small Canadian company, and they said if TPP had been in force, it would have made it much more difficult for them to have grown up. So the whole IPP, intellectual property rights, is designed for American corporations and by American corporations. And so there'll be a pushback on that. Again, this is where Mexico and Canada will be negotiating and not against the United States. In terms of the actual trade provisions, it's worth noting that after the TPP round was finished, the U.S. government, what's called the ITC, has to evaluate the impact on growth of the TPP, and the net effect when it's fully implemented of TPP was 0.15% of GDP. It was basically zero, and independent people said it was zero or negative. And the employment effects, you know, even if we bring back trade, bring back production, manufacturing production in the United States, it won't be jobs. And this goes back to the trade relations with China. So the trade part itself, again, really hard to figure out what you would do to rebalance that at this point. Now, the one thing that we should have done is trade assistance, and particularly when the economy is not at full employment. And the irony is the Republicans have consistently opposed that kind of trade assistance. The most recent empirical work on the impact of trade openness in the United States, after the interesting studies of what happened after the China's accession to the WTO, if you look at those places in the United States that produce goods that are competitive with those goods for which there was a surge of imports, unemployment is higher and wages are lower. So it's very clear that there has been an impact on the Rust Belt of trade. What we needed to have done is to recognize that, not to say markets adjust instantly and perfectly, and to have done something about it, but we didn't. And any new trade agreement ought to have something to deal with it. Final part of any trade agreement is how disputes are adjudicated. And particularly the private arbitration that was part of NAFTA will have to go. And I think, Canada would strongly support that. The real problem is the United States. So once again we open up that door, that will be a big point of debate. On the whole set of issues that were asked about taxes, I think that there will be a little bit on personal, and that will be the regressive part, some on corporate. The corporate rate will, as I say, they're not going to get the Ryan Brady bill, I think, and what they're going to do is bring down the tax rates, but it will be very modest increases. On the economics of the effect of bringing down corporate tax rates, the evidence is pretty, I think, pretty clear. For a big economy like the United States, very little effect. There are some particular provisions I'll come to in a second. If you're a small open economy in Europe, Ireland is able to get people not to locate there and put their main office there with zero employment and zero in order to get tax revenue. I mean, I'm joking about, you know, but Apple claimed to get all its global profits with 300 people operating in Ireland. So you get Ireland's GDP in 2015 increased at the rate of 26%. Now, if you believe that, the expression is, I have a bridge to sell you. But the fact is, that's the GDP accounting. It's all phony, and it's all because they're recording lots of activity, but it's not occurring in Ireland. It's all just tax gimmicks. It doesn't give them any. It gives them a little bit of revenue. It's a massive loss of revenues for the rest of Europe. Eventually, this is going to stop. And Vestager, the EU commissioner, has actually started this process. So that was a game they could play for a while, but it's basically that game is over. But in terms of real effect for a big economy like the United States, with tax deductibility of interest, and most investment is at the margin financed by debt, it has zero essentially zero effect. And so all of this is really just an attempt to lower the average tax rate, which if you're a corporation, you could understand why they're lobbying for that. But in terms of what would be the impact on the U.S. economy, I think it's really negligible. I wanted to just very briefly address your question about, for those of you, there is a theory of Berkeley economist Auerbach that don't worry about the border adjustment tax because the exchange rate will adjust. Now, the adjustment of exchange rate has big global effects for any emerging market that has signed contracts in dollars. So it will cause a major global perturbation. But the real question is, it will have an exchange rate effect. The question is, will it fully offset? I feel very confident the answer is no. If people believed it, one thing is true, you wouldn't get any trade benefit. And then they wouldn't be advocating it. So you have to believe that the reason they're advocating is because they don't really believe the exchange rate is going to undo the effect. There are a number of reasons why that won't happen. The obvious, one obvious one is if they do it, it will be challenged in WTO, and European countries are not going to wait. They're going to impose countervailing duties. And that will cast a pallor over what's going to happen in the future. If you think that there is a significant probability that it's going to be reversed, why would you have the exchange rate will be forward-looking and assume that this is not a permanent feature of the world going forward? So once you introduce that uncertainty, it's impossible for there to be a full offsetting effect. Let me pass it on to you, and then if we have time, I'll come.
I just want to say one other reason why border adjustment tax unlikely induce fully offsetting exchange rate changes. Many countries actually peg their currencies against dollar or manage their currencies very tightly with dollar. And that would affect that's not in Albert's calculation.
I wanted to say one thing about the last question was the question about the interest rate policy effect. And just two comments. One, I think in general there's too much of a focus on interest rate as the mechanism by which the economy is regulated. Availability of credit. It's a whole host of regulations that affect the flow of capital, and so that the idea that you should the excessive focus on interest rates, I think, has been misplaced. Now, I think we should have had a different monetary and fiscal mix. So we should have had more fiscal stimulus, and if we had done that, we would not have had to rely so much on low interest rates. And those low interest rates, I think, have distorted financial markets because for a variety of reasons, mainly related to behavioral finance, when interest rates are very low, risk premium get distorted. And so the structure of the financial markets gets distorted, and it raises all kinds of risk. So I don't think I would have done anything differently from what they did, but I think it would be good, it would be far better if we changed the fiscal monetary mix and moved to a world with higher interest rates, more normal interest rates with where the real interest rate is, if we're in a real interest rate of around 1-1.5%, which is where historically, and inflation is 1.5%, we're talking about a 3% nominal. We've had higher nominal rates because we had higher inflation rates. We're moving into a lower inflation period, so I think we'll wind up with a lower nominal interest rate.
me start with the question about the Rust Belt families and perhaps low-income American families in general. Joe cited a study by Professors Otto, Dong, and Hansen that says that imports, a massive increase in U.S. imports, contribute to unemployment. Now that leads, that gives rise to the temptation, not you, but others, that think only if we can reduce imports, make imports more expensive, that we could help low-income families. So the first thing to our note is that it's wrong in at least three ways, right? Number one, let's take the example of thinking through the consequence of raising tariff imports from China and Mexico. Number one, it's important to note, and it's very seldomly commented on, 60% of Chinese exports to the U.S. are intermediate goods, parts and components. They're going to other U.S. manufacturing firms. A big chunk of imports from Mexico are also parts and components. What does that mean? Well, for example, China is right now the number one foreign auto parts and component supply to U.S. auto companies. This means that making imports from China more expensive also will reduce global competitiveness of many U.S. manufacturing firms. One of the morning panelists, I remember, former Deputy Secretary of State, said that someone visited a company in the U.S. producing car seats or sofas, and it turns out half of the cost of a sofa, materials going to the sofa that came from China. Imagine a 45% tariff on that. That will make their sofa factory out of business right away. So in fact, people will lose job by protectionist policies. That's one channel why simply making imports more expensive will not help a low-income family. Second channel, of course, many of the imports, when they are final consumer goods from China, from Mexico, are imports at lower U.S. cost of a living, and they actually, most of Chinese made final products, for example, going to Walmart and the like. And they actually not just benefit American on average, they benefit low-income families disproportionately, because these are the goods that low-income families are more likely to buy than an average household. And the third channel is, of course, one cannot just focus on U.S. imports from China and Mexico and other countries. One should also look at U.S. exports to other countries. Some of you might recall that when President Obama first came to power, he said, I want to double U.S. exports in 5 years. Now, he failed. U.S. exports did not double in 5 years. But if you look at data, what you find is there are one or two markets in which U.S. exports did double. One of them is China. In fact, for the last 30 years, U.S. exports to China has consistently been growing so fast that it roughly doubles once every 5 years. In other words, if every country in the world were like China, U.S. would have achieved its goal of doubling its exports once every 5 years. But the job implication is, of course, behind every dollar of U.S. exports to China and other countries, there are also jobs. And precisely like what you said, a very aggressive trade action on China, particularly those that are inconsistent with WTO, not only will be challenged at WTO, they will be challenged by those countries' trade policy response as well, and they will reduce U.S. Exports and translating into reducing U.S. Jobs as well. I think that the fact that there's still insufficient recognition of this effects perhaps indicates failures of educators, maybe one solution is the SIPA and other schools need to train our students, not just train our students, but strategically train columnists, TV presenters, and so on, as well as advisors to the presidents and the cabinet. That's one. But the other, of course, is very important that we need to be much smarter in doing trade adjustment assistance. That trade, like technology changes, displace workers naturally. We need to do, the U.S. has a trade adjustment program. It hasn't seems to play as large a role as we would like, and one needs to figure out a way to do this. It's important to also note, in terms of helping people, it's not just helping people currently displaced by technology or trade. We also need to look at the future generation, children of the people who are currently working those those industries. So a better education system that allow young people, including children of people working in the sunset industries, acquiring the skills so that, you know, general purpose skills, that they can be flexible in their future jobs will be very, very, important. On Yang's question, of course, protectionism will be damaging to all countries, especially China, because China is one of the most open economies in the world in terms of trade to GDP ratio. So if the global trade were to shrink by 50%, China would be one of those countries that will get hurt the most. Could China play a more prominent role in leading next wave of globalization? You know, I think yes, there's some good chance for that. Most important reason is China benefits from globalization last 30 years. Almost all countries does, but China recognizes very, very clearly. And of course, China, that's one. And two is, of course, China is already doing many things that effectively are contributing to building up a more mutually beneficial global system, including the One Belt, One Road scheme, which is to help poorer countries to improve their infrastructure. The program may not, in the end, earn good returns for China. China may or may not realize this, but certainly be very good for whichever country they manage to get their infrastructure up through that program. The Asian Infrastructure Development Bank, of course, using Chinese foreign exchange, part of the foreign exchange, to lower macro risk member countries, improving infrastructure, is another concrete way in which countries, developing countries in particular in Asia and elsewhere, could benefit. China could not only when U.S. Retreats from TPP, that enhances the chance that China could make the so-called RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership negotiation successful. China could even revive TPP. TPP, mm-hmm. U.S.'s withdrawal from TPP. TPP is not dead in a technical sense. Ministerial meeting continues to hold. The very recent meeting, I think Chile was the host, invited China to join. I mean, from a very narrow political sense, people here worry that, wouldn't it be terrible for us if China leads the TPP? But that's a too narrow way to read this. China has an interest to make global economy stay open, both in trade and investment. It has benefited from this, and has it will suffer a lot from protectionism. Therefore, it would have a chance to want to make sure both TPP RCEP to stay, to follow a model that's called open regionalism, which is that not just member countries benefit, but the system will stay open to new non-members.
Thank you very much. Well, as you know, our speakers could go for another hour, but I'm here to stop them. So why don't we thank them all, and you can certainly talk to them in private.